Hi everyone, this is Andrew Oppmann with a special edition of Out of the Blue. These are web-only episodes that we're calling Stay on Course, and we're focusing on the people and preparations by the university in response to the COVID-19 emergency. Today is Tuesday, March 24th, and here are updates on the university's preparations regarding COVID-19. Effective Monday, the university implemented a plan for the majority of our employees, this is both classified and administrative, to work remotely. The provost, the vice presidents, division heads, and supervisors developed plans for their respective areas, and they've communicated those plans with their employees. These plans will be implemented through Sunday, April 5, and may be extended if deemed necessary. Now, there are some functions and duties that require some employees to remain on campus. Supervisors have reached out to those employees in those areas with those expectations. We will continue to provide essential services on campus, such as public safety, public health, and for our students in the residence halls, ongoing oversight and dining services. And we began remote delivery of instruction on Monday. MTSU will provide two options for partial refunds for those students who wish to vacate their resident hall or apartment early and move home. The options represent about a refund of 60% of the weighted average each week for a period of either 5 weeks or 3 weeks. Now, there's an option A and there's an option B. Option A, students who vacate anytime between March 17th, that's the day we announced that we would be changing because of the COVID-19 situation, and 8 p.m. Sunday, April 5th, will be eligible for a refund of $550. Option B, students who vacate anytime after 8 p.m. Sunday, April 5, and before 8 p.m. Sunday, April 19th, will be eligible for a refund of $330. If the student checks out after 8 p.m. Sunday, April 19th, no refund will be issued. Joining me on this edition of Stay on Course is Professor Ryan Korstange. He is in our University Studies program in University College. Now, he has been focusing on online instruction, and he's got some tips and hints for us to pass along to our students about this new era of remote delivery of instruction. Ryan, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
So let's talk about where we are right now and why we need to recalibrate our thinking regarding students.
Yeah, so students have experienced a tremendous amount of change. Their norms, their expectations are all different. Whereas they were coming to campus to learn, they're not anymore. And that's fine, and that's the response that we need to take. But because of that, their learning experience also looks different. And so we need to think about what learning looks like for a student as they're approaching learning from these remote delivery formats that we've developed.
You mentioned before we started the show that it's important that we not generalize, that every student's going to have a unique reaction to this situation. Talk about that.
Yeah, so our student body is really diverse. So there are people now who are taking care of children who are no longer able to go to school. There are people who aren't working. There are people who are working more. So for each of these students, their experience with remote learning has to be different. It is different. And so generalizing is just problematic and difficult. Mm-hmm. But so what we can do is we can kind of think about some best practices and some things that students need to think about as they make this shift to remote learning. And then the students are the ones who have to figure out how to make the shift with our support, of course, just reflecting their context and they find where they find themselves.
And one of the things you mentioned to me before the show was this is where you have to sort of habit realignment.
Yeah.
Or this might have been how I attacked or approached my studies. Right. Now I've really got to change everything in a lot of ways.
Right. So what we used to have is you used to have a pattern. You went to class, you saw a professor, there was some peer pressure for being there on time, you saw your friends, right? Like all of that.
Right.
Is all different now. You're going to class remotely. You have to remember to log into, it's a different process. You have to log in, you have to read the assignment, you have to watch a video, maybe you have to find some space in your in your house to do your work, right? Everything is different. So your old habits aren't gonna function the way that they have before. You have to develop new habits. It's a really big challenge for the students because we're developing new habits during this pandemic, this chaotic time, mm-hmm. With a shift to remote learning. So it's a very, there's a steep curve and students have to act quickly, or they have the opportunity to act quickly now to reform some habits and find success in their learning this semester.
I think you've already started mentioning a few of your tips for remote learning. You mentioned find a space for learning, right?
Yeah.
Carve it out.
Carve out a space, right? I'm working remote now too, so I've got a corner in my bedroom, right? It's not an ideal space, but it's a space. And when I sit down at the desk that I have, even though it's not the desk that I want to have, I know I can be productive and learn. When you're thinking about space, think about access to the internet. Think about having the materials that you need to study there with you. Think about having some distance from some of the other distractions in your house. There's a bunch of tips online for remote learning, but being successful starts with finding that space where you can concentrate.
You mentioned making time for learning, and I guess that's particularly important when you're in an environment where you're losing the distinction between home and class.
Yeah, and so that's the beauty in some ways of remote learning, is that time is a little bit more fluid, and so you can take the time that you need to learn when you have the time. One of the things we know about what gets called in our industry high impact practices, right? The high impact things where students learn really well, is that significant learning requires both time and effort, and that's gonna be a challenge right now, how to find the time and how to devote the effort to learning when other responsibilities have changed and other things feel more urgent and feel more pressing.
You mentioned also that you need to reach out to the available resources that we have, and I know from the note that Vincent Windrow sent out yesterday that remote tutoring starts on Wednesday, March 25th, and that schedule is going to be on our student success website, mtsu.edu/student-success. And there are also smart thinking online tutoring and supplemental instruction.
Yeah.
Walk me through those resources.
So tutoring, right, is the opportunity to sit down with somebody who's a peer who has a different understanding of the concepts than you have and to ask questions and get guided instruction. So the same benefit of tutoring that, I mean, we have face-to-face tutoring when we're allowed to be near each other. The same benefit that tutoring has exists in the remote setting. The difference is you're not sitting across the table, you're sitting across the computer. So from my perspective, in this time when things are difficult and different, making use of these services is more essential. What we know from research is that students who make use of support services are more successful at a higher rate and have better grades in their courses than students who don't make use of the services. And I'd also mention here that tutoring isn't the only service we have that's moved remote. Our writing center has done a tremendous job of developing remote stuff. Yeah, and their services are top-notch and haven't changed with remote delivery. And then we also have research coaching and research services from the Walker Library. Also, same, hasn't changed, and you can find information about the services that they're offering through their website.
I have a friend who is one of our online students who basically is helping along those who are just moving to the remote delivery, saying, listen, dude, there's so many things online. And you've touched on two of them. The Walker Library is just amazing, being able to help online students. And the Writing Center, I mean, they really have their act together online. They know how to help you remotely.
Yeah, and what I'd say is when you move online, it's a little bit more independent, right? You don't have the benefit of a conversation with somebody. So having somebody like the Writing Center or a tutor help you decode an assignment that your professor has given you and try to say, yeah, here's what I think those expectations are. Here's how you do that well, right? That's gonna take 10 minutes, but that's gonna mean all the rest of the work that you do is way more effective and more efficient. And that's what we need right now.
I love the phrase decode, because sometimes really that is what you need. You need to turn to the student to your left or right and go, what the heck did she mean? Or what the heck did he mean by that? And get that perspective, and they'll provide that.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that you can't lose as we've shifted to remote instruction. You can't lose that, you need it. You need that other perspective on not just assignments, but concepts and difficult things that are happening in class. So that's another tip that I would offer, is make sure that you find some support. So that support can be faculty members, right? You can ask faculty members questions. We all know that we made a shift to remote instruction in a week, and that leaves room for miscommunication.
Right.
So when things don't make sense, ask questions. That's within your right as a student. You ought to do that. We have an obligation as faculty members to help you understand what we're asking you to do. So ask those questions. You can find support from these resources. You can also find support from your classmates and your friends and your family. And do that. right? Even though it sounds weird, right? Take an assignment that doesn't make sense, run it past somebody who's not in your class or not even attending MTSU, and you might get some perspective and you might get some help.
Right.
And what you're doing by that, as if you take that initiative as a student, is you're putting time and effort into your learning that equals learning and that equals better performance.
Well, Professor, I know you coordinate our university studies, the 1010 classes,
yeah.
And the benefit of those great classes is that for those who take it, they get this sort of added advantage and maybe even a security blanket of knowing how the university works.
Yeah.
Give me a couple of closing pieces of advice here. What if you were talking to a student directly saying, you know, hey, Professor, how am I gonna cope with this?
Yeah.
How can I do this?
So I would say, figure out how you're gonna manage your time. That's the first thing. Time is hard right now, so what are you gonna do? What system are you gonna use? It doesn't have to be perfect, something. So write in a planner, make sure you don't lose track of the tasks that you have to do. That's the easiest way to do poorly in a remote class.
What's due by when?
What's due, when's it due, mm-hmm. How many points is it worth?
Right.
There's a couple of really good time management systems that I would recommend. There's one called the Pomodoro method. You work in 25-minute chunks and take 5-minute breaks. The beauty of that is it teaches you that you don't need 6 hours to be productive. You need 25 minutes of free time, and if you plan it well, you can be really productive working in short blocks. There's another system called time boxing, and you can Google this and find information about it. But time boxing says, look at your calendar, find when you have free time, and plan tasks that fit into the open time that you have. Those two strategies seem to me to be really important at this time. So those would be the two things that I would say. And then the other thing that I would say is MTSU distinguishes itself by being really concerned with student success. And so when things are confusing, ask. And it might be your professor who has an answer, or they might lead you to somebody else who has an answer, or it might be a tutor who has an answer, or they might lead you, but there are people here who are gonna find the answers for you. So don't feel like this shift to remote instruction means that you're this like passive recipient of information and you're anonymous and you're back in your apartment or your home or wherever, right? You matter. We want you to be successful. We need to know where you're struggling because it's going to be a little bit harder for us to see that, but let us know and we'll help you however we can do it.
Well, Professor, this is great stuff. We appreciate everything the faculty have done to prepare for this remote instruction period. I mean, Herculean tasks in a short period of time. And Ryan, you particularly for being a great additional supplemental resource with your tips and information for students. Thank you for everything.
Yeah, no problem. Happy to be here.
This does wrap up another edition of Out of the Blue. You can find more information about the university's response to the coronavirus on our special website, mtsu.edu/coronavirus. I'm Andrew Oppmann, and on behalf of all of us here at Out of the Blue, stay on course and remain true blue.